Hey, boys and girls, this is Neuronymous here, and I was just thinking, Patton Oswalt, really big fan of him. He's a stand-up comic. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of him. He had this bit about his late wife, true crime writer Michelle McNamara, who passed away, unfortunately. He got a text from her saying something like, "I love you," or something like that. And his response was to be, "I love you too." But instead, what happened was it autocorrected, and he just sends a message saying, "I hate." And so every so often, my wife and I will text, like when we're having a bad day, we'll just type, "I hate." Nothing in particular, just, "I hate." Just pure, unadulterated, "I hate." But anyway, so this podcast is just sort of, I don't know. I just chugged a big bottle of Dr. Pepper, and I gotta talk about some of my pet peeves. If you guys are gonna get to know me on this podcast, you're gonna need to learn about my pet peeves. And yes, there will be some profanity in this. So if profanity is not your thing, or politics for that matter, because I really normally don't talk about politics. But anyway, I'm feeling very like a live wire right now. So I feel like I want to air some pet peeves out, okay? So the first pet peeve is if you ask me how I'm doing, like, if you come up to me and say, "Hey, how are you doing?" Or if you call me up and say, "Hey, how are you doing?" Let me answer, okay? Just let me answer the question. Don't talk over me. It's fucking rude, okay? The thing is, like, sometimes I'm not having a good day. If you don't want to know what my day is like, don't ask, okay? Don't ask unless you really want to know the answer. It's like, the old saying, don't, if you can't do, don't do the time if you can't, don't do the crime if you can't do the time. Don't ask me how I'm doing if you don't give a shit how what my response is. That is my biggest pet peeve. Like, I'll ask, somebody will ask me, "Hey, how you doing?" I'll be like, and I've gotten to the point where I will literally talk over them until they're like, "Wait, what?" I'm like, "Well, you asked me how I was doing, so I'm telling you how I'm doing." And they're like, "Oh, okay." And I kind of get a little bit of joy of them just awkwardly, like, just kind of like going like, "Oh shit, I guess I was kind of rude." Anyway, so that's pet peeve number one. Pet peeve number two, lately I joined this thing called BookBub, and I love it. It tells me when all the books are coming out, not when they're coming out, but what books are on sale on Amazon, and I get a daily email, and I read my Kindle. I love my Kindle. It's one of my favorite things in the world to do. I love reading. You'll find that out. I love to talk about books, memoirs. Right now I'm reading getting to the Waiting for the Punch. It's a book by Mark Maron. Mark Maron, who runs a podcast, told me I drink a lot of Dr. Pepper, so I'm a little bit hyper. Anyway, so lately though, in my Facebook feed, my news feed, I keep getting books that say, "If you like this, then you'll love this." If you like Steve, and for example, if you like Stephen King, you'll love this. If you like Jack Reacher, who's a character that Lee Child is the author of that creator of that character, if you love Jack Reacher, you'll love this. If you love the Dresden Files, you'll love this. And it's it just goes on and on. And I'm just like, stop doing that. Stop comparing your book to something else. Be your own thing, man. Just like don't. You don't have to. Just. You're an author, you're a writer, you've created something. It's your baby. Don't try and compare it to something else. Don't try and make it something else. Make it your own. For God's sakes. Ugh, it bothers me so much. I just, like, I'm not going to unsubscribe from BookBub, but, like, it's getting to a point where I just want to be like, really? Don't, you're not Stephen King. You're not Lee Child. You're not Dean Koontz. You're not, you know, like, you know, you're, like, you know, what is it? 16 Shades of Black or whatever it's called. Three Shades of Gray. I've lost track of how many shades there are of this gray guy. So anyway, yeah, and you know that's just, and this is, and the next pet peeve is really, it's a personal one, it really is near and dear to my heart, and I think this is for everybody. Don't ask me, or anyone for that matter, when they're gonna get pregnant and have babies, and or how is, and in our case also, how is the adoption going? First of all, it's none of your fucking business, okay? If, you know, when we're gonna have children, most likely it's not gonna happen. Unfortunately, we both have issues. We can't have children, at least biologically, okay? Secondly, you know, there are, like I said, I mean, and it's not just us. I mean, there are people out like us who cannot have children. So asking them, hey, when are you going to make me an uncle? Or, you know, when are you, you know, when are you going to have, when are you guys going to have some little ones running around the house? Well, you know what? It may not fucking happen. It ain't going to happen, probably. At least not biologically, as I've said. So anyway, lastly, you know, if you know someone who is trying to adopt, such as us, do not, and I mean do not, try and, quote, you know, kind of console them or us by telling us, who, you know, hey, you know who's trying to adopt? So-and-so. But after adopting or going, trying to go through the process, they got pregnant. You know what? Our, you know, get, you know, adopting a child is an amazing, it's going to be a blessing. And we had a really horrible experience. And I don't like talking about it because, at least not right now, because if I do, it might make me cry, and I don't want to cry on this podcast today. But here's the thing. You know, by saying, like, you know who got pregnant, and then, you know who's trying to adopt, and then they got pregnant, it's almost like you're saying, hey, that the baby that you adopted is like a consolation gift. Now you got the real thing. You got a real baby. You know, to me, it's like I said, it's just insulting. It's insulting. And, you know, trying to start a family is, it should be an easy thing, but for some people it's not. And you gotta be sensitive about that. You gotta rein it in and, you know, just mind your own damn business, okay? How is the adoption going? If we have news about the adoption, if we are going to be adopting a child, trust me, we will definitely tell you, okay? You don't have to ask us. We'll be so excited that we will probably tell you up front. You don't need to badger us with that. You know, it's just annoying, and it's rude, and it's insensitive. Okay? So there's that. Also, another pet peeve, MoviePass. Okay, so I love my parents. I love them. They're amazing people, and they got me an amazing gift last year for Hanukkah. They got me a year subscription to MoviePass, which was great. I got at least 6 good months of being able to go out and see whatever movie I wanted whenever I wanted to. Okay. But since then, I don't know I know that they've had issues with funding, losing their financial, it doesn't matter anymore. You know, like, I can't go see movies with MoviePass anymore. And all I gotta say is, MoviePass, get your shit together, guys, okay? Your business model was fucked. Either do what you say you're gonna do, that is, you know, let me go see movies. That's just kind of like the basic core concept of MoviePass, right? It makes me angry. I wanted to go see A Star Is Born because I love the soundtrack. I haven't even seen the movie, but I'm in love with the soundtrack, and I can't even see the movie. I know. Yes, I know. I could spend money and go see a movie, but funds are tight, and I can't afford to just go out and see movies. Movies are expensive. They're expensive to go to. So yeah. Hopefully it'll come to the cheap theater. I'm sure it will, but again, they're not participating in MoviePass, it would seem, as well. So, anyway. If I'm being honest, I feel like the company has taken a giant dump on its customers. Fuck you, MoviePass. Fuck you. Okay? Like, seriously, get your shit together. Either let me go see movies or don't let me get, or close shop, because this isn't working for a lot of people and it's just making people angry. So do what you're going to do or don't do what you're going to do. Okay. Next pet peeve, bashing the band U2. Okay. Here's the deal. I am a huge U2 fan. Okay. And I know a lot of people who don't, they don't like them. And that's fine. Everybody has different musical differences. Some people like a lot, everybody likes different types of music. That's fine, okay? But there's this weird thing like they're fake or they're goody-goodies or sellouts because they're political. And then there was that whole debacle about, getting their album on like the iPhone. It was like an automatic it was in an automatic update that the album was put on the iPhone. But you know what? I thought it was pretty cool. But again, that's because I'm a U2 fan. But, worst of all, I was talking to somebody and they're like, they don't know how to play their instruments. What do you mean? What do you mean they don't know how to play their instruments? Are you fucking kidding me? I think, they've been around for about 30 years. I'm pretty sure they know how to play their fucking instruments, okay? This is my thought. Why don't you go make yourself a fucking multi-million record and go platinum? Why don't you do that? Oh, you can't? I'm sorry. I guess maybe you don't know how to play your musical instruments. Huh. I wonder. It really bothers me. Like I said, maybe it's because I'm a U2 fan, but I just get really angry and I get really protective of them because they were really like they got me through some really hard times. And yes, they know how to play their instruments. Maybe Bono's voice is getting a little bit rugged as the years have progressed. I think he's kind of losing some of his luster as far as singing. Probably because I think he's a smoker. I could be wrong. I remember seeing some sort of weird breathing attachment or something that, lubricated his voice. It looked like something out of, like a Rob Zombie movie that he had, like, this weird suction cuppy thing attached to his face. I don't know what it's called. But anyway. But yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure U2 knows how to play their musical instruments. They're not sellouts. I think they mean well, and they do a lot of charitable stuff. And whether you think that that's, fake, okay, all right. So I guess, trying to give money to Africa is fake, or trying to help the, world hunger is fake. I guess maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. But that's it. That's all I got about U2. So, U2, rock on. I've seen them in concert. I could have gone without the Kanye West opening act. I think he's a piece of shit. And which leads us, you ready? You ready? It leads us to Donald Trump. Wow. Just wow. What a dumpster fire of a fucking shit show. This guy that we have in the Oval Office is a sexist, misogynistic piece of shit. He has absolutely no idea what he's doing. No fucking clue. the man can't stay off of fucking Twitter. And, you know, and I know this is all stuff that's been said and done. I realize I'm not unique. You know, this is on a lot of people's minds. But I used to, you know, I used to think that people got meaner when he was elected. But I think I got it wrong. I think we were already this hateful, sadly enough. But I think the Trump getting elected, that just tapped into and unlocked that anger, that hate, that bigotry. I think it tapped into it and it gave people permission to say, guess what? Now I can be who I really want to be. I really want to be an asshole. You know? And I'm like, again, I don't mention where I work, but I tell you, since Trump has been elected, I feel like people have gotten meaner. Meaner and just outright rude, and it's sad. It really is. You know, I'm not saying our country was perfect to begin with, or the people in our country are perfect, but I can tell you, like, when it was, you know, when during the Bill Clinton years, or the, you know, basically during the 90s, we had a pretty good run. I think the 90s were a pretty good run. You know, if you're anti-Clinton or whatever, maybe you might disagree, or, you know, if you're a Republican, whatever. But this Trump thing, it's just, I don't know. How has he not been impeached yet? How has he not? I mean, the moment he made fun of a man's disability by mimicking him, I mean, that should have been fucking it, man. I have a disability. And his cruelty, I mean, and I don't, you know, like, you know, cry poor about my disability, because it is what it is. I've, you know, it's just part of who I am. But, you know, like, I have a disability. It's just, it is what it is. And and his cruelty and insensitivity was a personal offense to me and everyone with physical or mental disabilities. Donald Trump, the real our president of the United States. What were you thinking? Like, seriously, this is not how we chose our life to be. I mean, it's part of who we are, but it, you know, like, to make fun of someone's disability, it's a terrible thing. It's unconscionable. You know, look, we're better than this. I know this is a big rambling podcast episode, but you know what? I don't really give a shit. We are better than this. At least that's what I thought. I mean, as time goes by, I'm really starting to wonder. I mean, is this what we've become? I read somewhere that we get the world that we deserve. Which is actually, if I'm being honest with you, it's actually the slogan for True Detective Season 2. Which wasn't even that great of a season. I mean, it was all right, but there's the tagline for that episode was, "We get the world we deserve." And you know what? I think it's absolutely true. This is the world that we have, and unfortunately, a lot of us, everybody has to own it. Sadly, you know, we don't have to accept it, but we have to own the fact that this is our country now. This is our world. Do we deserve the cruel world that we're living in? I hope not. I hope not. I hope the world doesn't end in fire and flames I hope not. But here's the thing. The fact that I can still hope means something. I haven't given up yet. I haven't given up. And honestly, you shouldn't either. You shouldn't either. Because if you have any hope left, that's all you need is just, you know, just be kind to one another, okay? You know, just take it one, as I always say, one day at a time. And, you know, really, to quote, you know, a wise man, I'm gonna quote a wise man.
Time, take care of yourself and each other.